I was probably like 14 or 15, and I ended up getting into like a weird friend group in school.
What are you doing?
I did get expelled.
And started meeting a bunch of new people and started, you know, smoking weed, and really that was it back then, going to parties and stuff like that. And then it really, after that, it just kind of progressed, you know, being in that situation. I started doing other things, and that led down a long path of, you know, getting in trouble with the police and, you know, a whole bunch of other stuff.
County, which direction do you say he's running?
West on Mini Alley. White male, black hair, blue hoodie.
23 units. I got a white male, no shirt, black pants. He's eastbound on Mini Alley.
Tell the truth to a friend. I ain't felt this free since the summer began. You got my number again. I'm falling over you, friend. This love is overdue. I think I'll party to death. It's too late to save me. I'm already dead.
Give me your trust. Give me your love. I want more than money.
It's not just kids who come from families where their parents may have been involved in the system, or they have parents who've been incarcerated who commit crimes. It puts them at a higher risk, and so that's why we talk about family, because it's one of the things that we look at. But you know, crime really does not discriminate among juveniles.
Kids are more violent today. They're definitely more violent. They're more apt to have a weapon or to use a weapon. You know, back in the 80s or 90s, you know, kids would rumble, and that would be it. You know, now it's a whole different ball game.
I personally have dealt with offenders who I've dealt with since elementary school through middle high school, and now I've dealt with them committing extremely serious adult crimes. And again, I've been able to watch, catalog, and try to assist in every level. And again, there's always going to be a portion of a certain population that are not going to be able to break out of that cycle. It's unfortunate. You still try. You still try to get through them. You still treat everyone with the same care that you can. But it does break your heart when you have that happen, even though you've tried.
I remember stealing my grandmother's prescription pain medication before I burnt down the second house I burnt down, which I was 7 at that time. So while I was still in that house, I had memories of stealing her pills and like getting high on them in that trailer. And I know for a fact I burned that trailer down when I was 7. So sometime before I was 7. And then I more or less did a lot of pills. Like, that's all I ever did. I'd go to school with handfuls of pills, take them on the school bus on the way to school. And then I started smoking weed when I was 10. And that more or less was like when I realized, like, I don't even like pills, you know, like I don't like that at all. So I just started smoking weed, and I was fine for a little bit. But throughout all this process, the kid that lived down the road, he was like 8 years older than I was. He had a really bad meth addiction, and he was like my right-hand man, you know. Anytime I'd leave my mom's house, I'd go hang out with him and help him work on his truck or foilers, you know, whatever it might be, I'd help him with it. And after so long of seeing him always getting high on, you know, these hard drugs, it kind of normalized it in my mind. And one day he just asked me, he's like, yo, you want to try this? You know, why not? Sure. I want to be like you, you know. I looked up to him. I thought he was my role model. And, you know, in all reality, looking back on it now, he didn't have his own role model, you know. Like, we were both just as screwed as what, you know, I thought I was at the time. He was just as bad, but I didn't realize that. So more or less at 12 years old, I started doing crystal meth. Just about anything else that I could ever get my hands on. The only thing I didn't ever do was like heroin. That's basically the only drug I've never done. You know, oh, and crack, never done crack either. But just about everything else I, you know, had my little bit of fun with, had my time with, but crystal meth was always my demon. Like, I went from 12 till 19 fully addicted to crystal meth. It got to the point where I was using needles, and it wasn't even so much the high off the crystal meth, it was the rush of the actual injection where, like, you feel like you're gonna die. You know, like that's the only way I know how to put it. Like you feel like you're on the edge of like, I might die, I might not, you know, but I'm gonna hold on and ride it out and hope and pray it gets better.
Guns were always around, you know. Anybody I ever knew, back when I was, you know, going down the wrong path, I mean, everybody had guns. Everybody I spoke to, everybody I hung out with, like, they're there, they're around. Never really thought anything of it, though. It didn't matter, it didn't scare me.
I can't let him take my soul.
A child brought up in an environment where they're constantly shown one way instead of another, it's very difficult to break that cycle and to show them a different way to prosper, a different way to succeed in life. We're only a small piece within a young person's life. Unfortunately, there are only so many hours of the day, and they're still going to be deeply involved in that environment. Again, some do. There's quite a few people that actually will break out of that cycle. There's unfortunately a large number that do not.
I have said more than once in a custody trial that to parents that if they don't stop what they're doing, their kid's going to wind up in the juvenile system because they're creating such dysfunction in the household. You know, if you grow up in a household where both of your parents have been in the criminal system, or one of them, or you don't have a father figure, which is very rampant, I think those kids, you know, they're at higher risk of getting involved in the juvenile system.
My father's been in state prison my entire life. I've never met my father outside of state prison. So like even from a real young age, I always thought it'd be cool to do, you know, 10 plus years in state prison, or, you know, get arrested and do just crazy stuff all the time. So that's how I lived until I was old enough to realize that's not really what I wanted.
Consistently, from the time I became chief and started looking at the numbers every year, fighting and theft were always number one and number two, along with unpaid fine and costs. They were our top three referrals to our office. Past 5 or 10 years, we've seen an increase in riots, what the police call a riot, which is just a, you know, 5, 10, 15 kids fighting in the hallways, in the CAF, at schools. We've seen an increase in mental health issues, problems, not only with the parents, but also with their children and siblings. And that right there has been the biggest, I think, hurdle and obstacle for us to overcome, because we're probation officers and we are trained to deal with at-risk behavior, criminal behavior. We supervise kids in the community. We were never trained to deal with the mental health issues and the mental health illnesses that are out there. And the depression, the anxiety, the other forms that takes just threw us for a loop, and we were just not ready for it. So before I retired, probably the last 4 years, we really pushed mental health training and mental health programming, not only for our staff, but for our kids, because it was just going through the roof.